Hello guys, this is Indian Medico and in this video we are going to see about endometriosis. This is a concise presentation for medical students. Endometriosis is defined as the presence of endometrial glands and stroma outside the uterus. As you can see in this picture, there is endometrial glands and stroma outside the uterus in various places. This is known as endometriosis. Now let us see about the various risk factors for developing endometriosis. Early menarche, heavy menstrual bleeding, short menstrual cycles, delayed childbearing, low parity, higher social class, family history of endometriosis, especially in a first degree relative, low body mass index, obstructive Mullerian anomalies that prevent normal menstruation, and dioxins, which are toxic environmental pollutants, are the various risk factors for developing endometriosis. Now let us see about pathogenesis of endometriosis. There are various theories regarding endometriosis. The first theory is implantation theory. It was proposed by Samson. According to this theory, endometrial fragments transported through the tubes into the peritoneal cavity by retrograde menstruation, and these cause endometriosis. Now let us see about coelomic metaplasia theory. The cells of original coelomic membrane undergo metaplasia, leading to endometriosis. Coming to induction theory, the degenerating menstrual endometrium releases endogenous factors which induce metaplasia of coelomic epithelium and cause endometriosis. Endometriosis can also be caused due to venous and lymphatic dissemination of endometrial cells. Now let us see about immunological theory of endometriosis. Decreased cellular immunity to endometriotic tissue causes decreased clearance of shed endometrial cells from peritoneal cavity, leading to endometriosis. Genetic factors can also cause endometriosis. This explains the familial predisposition for endometriosis. Molecular defects leading to increased production of cytokines, growth factors, and estrogens can also lead to endometriosis. This picture shows Samson's theory of retrograde menstruation and also the stem cell hypothesis causing endometriosis. Now let us see about the mechanism of developing endometriosis in detail. Genetic factors, immunological factors, molecular defects, and mechanical factors cause implantation of endometrial cells in ectopic sites. These implanted endometrial cells later adhere to peritoneal surface. Then there will be angiogenesis, followed by growth of endometrial cells, proliferation, inflammatory reaction, and finally endometriosis. Now let us see about the various biologically active substances involved in each step. Cytokines help in addition of implanted endometrial cells to peritoneal surface. Matrix metalloproteinase cause invasion of the endometrial cells. Vascular endothelial growth factor causes angiogenesis. Growth factors also play a role in the growth of endometrial cells. Estrogen causes proliferation of endometrial cells. Prostaglandins are involved in inflammatory reaction. Now let us see about the pathology of endometriosis. In superficial or peritoneal endometriosis, there will be endometrial glands and stroma in the dependent portion of pelvis. There can be endometrial glands and stroma in surface of ovaries, in pelvic peritoneum or anterior and posterior surfaces of uterus, in the pouch of Douglas, in uterosacral ligaments, and in broad ligaments. This picture shows superficial or peritoneal endometriosis. As you can see, there are different foci of endometriosis, and the blood is darker in these foci and they appear as powder ones. They can also appear as red or white or black lesions. Now let us see about deep ovarian endometriosis or endometrioma. The superficial endometriosis can become invaginated and can lead to the formation of cysts which are filled with old blood containing hemosiderin. In this case, it is called as deep ovarian endometriosis or endometrioma. As you can see, these are the endometriomas. This picture shows endometrioma. This is a laparoscopic image of endometrioma. This picture shows the chocolate cyst filled with old blood containing hemosiderin. The cyst wall of endometrioma is white or yellow, and the cyst is filled with thick chocolate colored fluid, hence they are called as chocolate cysts. Now let us see about deep infiltrating endometriosis. They may be present in the posterior pelvic wall. They are also known as posterior pelvic endometriosis. The lesions extend greater than 5 mm beneath the peritoneum. They may be present in the rectovaginal space, uterosacral ligaments, cervix, bowel or ureters. The lesions cause inflammatory reaction which lead to the formation of adhesions. So in this case, endometriosis mimics malignancy. Now let us see about extrapelvic endometriosis. Before seeing about extrapelvic endometriosis, we first need to know what is pelvic endometriosis. Pelvic endometriosis is when endometriosis occurs in ovaries, tubes, uterine surfaces, pelvic side walls and pelvic endometrium. So if endometriosis occurs in places other than these places, it is called as extrapelvic endometriosis. They can occur elsewhere in the peritoneal cavity, other body cavities or surgical scars. Common places of extrapelvic endometriosis include bladder, ureters, sigmoid colon, rectum, ileocecal area, appendix, small intestine, surgical scars of cesarean section and episiotomy, lungs and pleura. Now let us see about the microscopic appearance of endometriosis. Endometriotic tissue contains endometrial glands and stroma along with hemosiderin laden macrophages. This picture shows small cluster of endometrial glands and stroma with hemorrhage. This is the endometrial glands and stroma with hemorrhage. This is the lumen of fallopian tube. So this is endometrial glands and stroma present outside the uterus. Now let us see about the symptoms of endometriosis. Endometriosis can be asymptomatic or there can be pain. Pain can be in the form of severe dysmenorrhea or chronic pelvic pain or ovulation pain or pain of defecation and deep dyspareunia. The causes of pain includes peritoneal inflammation, activation of nociceptors, nerve irritation with deep infiltration, tissue damage, local production of prostaglandins, adhesion formation, and it can also be due to collection of blood in endometriotic implants. Other symptoms of endometriosis include menstrual abnormalities, which can present in the form of heavy menstrual bleeding and premenstrual spotting. Causes of these include anovulation and also abnormal follicular development. Endometriosis can cause infertility. Endometriosis is a reason for 30-45% of infertility in women. Causes of infertility in endometriosis include ovulatory dysfunction due to abnormal folliculogenesis, anovulation, luteal phase defect, and luteinized unruptured follicle syndrome. Other causes of infertility in endometriosis are immunological alterations leading to decreased sperm survival and altered immunity, peritoneal factors, that is intraperitoneal inflammation and local production of prostaglandins or cytokines, interference with implantation due to endometrial dysfunction, mechanical factors like anatomical distortion of tubes, interference with ovum pickup, altered tubal motility and peritubal adhesions can also be seen in endometriosis leading to infertility. Endometriosis can cause dyspareunia and it can interfere with coital function. Endometriosis can cause sperm inactivation due to phagocytosis by macrophages and also due to inactivation by antibodies. Other symptoms of endometriosis include cyclic hematuria when bladder is involved and cyclic bleeding from rectum, which is not very common. Now let us see about the signs of endometriosis. Endometriosis can present as pelvic mass. This is seen in large endometriomas. They may become palpable abdominally. Large endometriomas are fixed to surrounding structures. They can cause recurrent bleeding leading to fibrosis. Other signs include retroverted and fixed uterus, tender uterosacral ligaments and nodules in pouch of Douglas. How will a patient with endometriosis present to you? The patient will present with history of congestive dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia and chronic pelvic pain. Usually the presentation is a young woman with infertility. Examination of a case of endometriosis may not reveal any abnormality. In some cases, in abdominal examination, we can find a mass arising from pelvis, which is located in iliac fossa, which is tender and which is not freely mobile. On perspeculum examination, vaginal lesions can be seen, which are bluish nodules in posterior fornix. Pelvic examination might reveal fixed retroverted uterus, adnexal mass which may be tender and fixed, and tender uterosacral ligaments. Perrectal or rectovaginal examination can be done. It may reveal tenderness and nodules in pouch of Douglas. What are the investigations done in a case of endometriosis? USG and MRI can be done for ovarian endometriomas. Barium studies can be done for severe endometriosis involving the bowel. IV urography can be done for severe endometriosis involving the ureter. CA125 might be elevated in endometriosis, but it is not useful as diagnostic tool. Laparoscopy is the gold standard investigation for endometriosis. In laparoscopy, we can visualize the lesions, stage the disease, we can take biopsy for histology, we can evaluate extent of adhesions, and we can do therapeutic intervention if needed. This picture shows USG images of endometrioma. This is an MRI image of endometrioma. These are laparoscopic pictures of endometriosis. Now let us see about the classification and staging of endometriosis. Endometriosis is classified and staged based on revised American Fertility Society classification and scoring. Points are given for size, depth, location of endometriotic lesions, periovarian adhesions and pouch of Douglas obliteration. There are four stages: minimal stage, mild stage, moderate stage and severe stage. Now let us see about the management of endometriosis. It is important to remember that there is no permanent cure for endometriosis. The aim of medical management is pain relief and prevention of progression of endometriosis. The various drugs that can be used are NSAIDs like mefenamic acid, progestins like medroxyprogesterone acetate and levonorgestrel intrauterine system. Combined oral contraceptive pills can be used. GnRH agonists like leuprolide and gosarilin can be used. Anti-gonadotropins like danazol can also be used. These drugs can be given preoperatively to make surgery easier. What is the principle of these drugs? Ectopic endometrium responds to ovarian estrogen and progesterone. This suppresses ovulation and this suppresses ovarian steroidogenesis, leading to decreased pain and prevention of progression of endometriosis. Now let us see about surgical management of endometriosis. The indications for surgical management includes ineffective medical management, chronic pelvic pain, ovarian endometrioma and infertility. In cases of superficial endometriosis, we can do coagulation of superficial lesions with electrocautery or laser. Adhesiolysis can be done. and laparoscopic uterosacral nerve ablation can also be done. In ovarian endometriomas, if the diameter is less than 3 cm, we can do aspiration and irrigation followed by vaporization or excision of inner wall. If the diameter is greater than 3 cm, we have to do ovarian cystectomy. This picture shows intraoperative pictures of endometrioma. In case of deep infiltrating and advanced endometriosis, surgical management includes hysterectomy, bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy along with bowel resection or ureteric resection according to the extent of endometriosis. There can be recurrences and the patient should be given a combination of estrogen and progestin after hysterectomy has been done. This picture shows total hysterectomy. This is hysterectomy plus bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, which is usually done for deep infiltrating and advanced endometriosis. Now let us see about the management of infertility in a case of endometriosis. The various treatment options for infertility in endometriosis includes ovulation induction, controlled hyperstimulation with intrauterine insemination, in vitro fertilization, and intracytoplasmic sperm injection. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. For more such videos, please check out my gynecology playlist. Thank you.